and Tom Brislin over there, our former director of the Carol Burnett Fund. Thank you, Tom, for all your service. And we have many of our faculty here as well. As our two discussants today are Tom Cooper, who's a visiting scholar here. Tom, raise your hand, they're at this table. They're gonna come up here afterward. Tom Cooper and Bev Kiever, our professor emerita from our School of Communication. Thank you. I'm Ann Allman, I think many of you know me, but I'd like to tell you a little bit first about the Carol Burnett story and how we got this $100,000 gift to our program. It's making this event possible. In 1982, she sued the National Enquirer for libel and won after the Enquirer described her alleged public drunkenness, which wasn't true. The case was a landmark for libel cases involving celebrities. So she donated a portion of that award, $800,000, to us, as well as University of California, Berkeley, the graduate program, saying she hoped that the suit and the funds would help teach aspiring journalists the dangers of defaming individuals. So the Hawaii Award supports teaching and research in journalism ethics, as well as student awards, which are our local awards as well as national awards. We have Dr. Ward here. Come stand up with me.
All right.
Aloha and welcome.
Thank you.
I became intrigued with Dr. Ward's ideas through his writing on global media ethics. He's an emerging scholar in this area and always pushing the boundaries. And what better place than Hawaii, the bridge between East and West, to host a discussion on global ethics. We're cooking up some ideas for the future on that as well. So it's my privilege to share with you Dr. Stephen Ward. He is Distinguished Lecturer in Ethics at the University of British Columbia and founding director of the Center for Journalism Ethics at the University of Wisconsin, which is where he's residing right now. What I like about his work is he blends theory and practice. He's creative and analytic and takes a holistic approach to his work. He's also a prolific writer. Where's your book? I'm going to show that later. Who brings professional journalism experience,
by the book.
Radical media ethics. Professional experience, he was a war correspondent. If you have the flyer, there's more details on the front and back. The back also has information about the Carol Burnett gift. And I do have a more extensive bio on him if you're interested in a copy of that. He's also a good Canadian. Doesn't that say it all? You can read more about him in the flyers at the door. And after his talk, Dr. Tom Cooper and Dr. Bev Kiever will come up here to be our discussants. And all of you are invited to ask questions. So Dr. Cooper, in the red shirt, you want to wave your hand? He's a visiting scholar, our School of Communications and the East-West Center, and is well-published in this area. And Bev Kiever, as you know, is our professor emerita from our journalism program. And I think she trained most of the journalists in the state. Didn't you, Beth? Okay, thanks very much. Thanks, aloha, welcome.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Well, thank you, everyone. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
All right. I'm so pleased to be here and particularly be chosen to be to give the Carol Burnett lecture this year, given all the very illustrious people who have given those talks before me. It's quite a humbling thing to be asked to do. And I've been to Hawaii several times on holiday and business, but this is especially good for me. I hear that that Tom was trying to buy me off with treats just a while ago with a gift. I know he's got some really tough questions. He's just being nice. And I'm not, and I don't have all the answers, so I'm sure I'll be stumped by some of the questions they have. What I'm gonna talk about, I'm just gonna dive in here, is something called global media ethics, which is this big abstract term, right? And I'm gonna try to talk about the practical side of this issue. The first thing you should know, if you're not aware, is that there's something you might call as a movement towards greater global notions and global emphasis in journalism and media ethics. And there is a real question whether this is going anywhere or nowhere. And I think it's legitimate to be skeptical about this. That's why there is a legitimate question mark there. Is this just utopian in the negative sense, although utopian thought has a lot of history in our culture, utopian in the negative sense being, it'll never happen, it's a waste of time, even if it were desirable. Realistic means there's a chance that we can actually, this can become a force in journalism and media practice. And so this is, and I'm going to be focusing, I'm going to very quickly try to tell you what global media ethics is. That's the sort of theory, conceptual part. I'm going to go very light on that, although I've written a lot on it. I want to focus on what I call the practical side, which is what are the prospects for really realizing this? I'll give you some discouraging trends, some reasons for the skeptics to say this is going nowhere or whatever. I'll also give you some encouraging trends so you don't walk out here completely discouraged. I'll talk about some, at the end, some things we can do and maybe, and not maybe, but will have a conclusion for you on all of that. So what is GME? Basically, it is actually the attempt to articulate norms of media that is now global in content, reach, and impact. And that changes the ballpark, in my view, for the sort of ways we practice journalism and even the understanding of the norms we have used in the past to guide journalism. And so it also means new ways of practice, which I'll try to show you, with respect to how we actually approach the reporting and analysis of what are called global issues. And it is fairly controversial because it aims to reform and in some cases replace some of the previous journalism ethics, which was non-global or parochial in my terminology. The usual reasons given for why we would even consider global media ethics, one is simply the goal of journalism is still informing the public accurately and partially and so on and so forth. But from a global perspective, well, one thing is you can simply cite a simple moral rule. You got impact, you got duties. You got impact, you got responsibilities. You got global impact, you got global responsibilities. How do you get out of that one, right? So from a moral, simple moral principle point of view, you can argue that, in fact, the very fact that the institution of media has this global impact means it doesn't get a get-out-of-jail card in ethics. Right? That in fact they should and should be held accountable for the global effect they have. The second one has to do with dealing with global issues. What I mean by that is issues that require cooperation of a number of countries for it to be solved. From climate change to the immigration and refugee situation that we've seen in Europe, on and on in those areas. Also, it's the way the world is, strikes me, that global media ethics should be something considered. What I mean by pluralism is you have a world that is of democracies and that is increasingly plural of contending traditions and philosophies of life. And that we as journalists can make that worse and exacerbate tensions between those groups, or we can actually try to bring them together in some sort of agreement on various issues. And also, I think the inadequacy of current or our past and traditional journalism ethics frameworks. I call it parochial in this sense. It was constructed for a journalism that was not global. It was constructed for a journalism that saw its duty to a city, a public belonging to a nation, but not necessarily anything beyond the nation. If you go back in the history of codes of ethics and journalism, you get a lot of talk of serving the public, but the subcode there, or the understanding of the public, is our nation. So nationalism, in many cases, was sort of the implicit understanding below those codes. And so journalism ethics traditionally has not said a lot about, well, what happens when your stories go across borders and spark riots? What about that? What does your code say about that? What does your code say when, in fact, we should be mending differences and helping people and traditions understand each other, when, in fact, all your codes talk about is the freedom of expression? Right? There's huge, huge conceptual and philosophical issues here. I'm not trying to sort these things out right now, or even if I could right now. So my notion is that we're moving slowly away from this parochial base, and how far can we get and should we get in moving towards a more global formulation? Okay? So that's what I think it is. The usual ethical basis, theoretical basis for global media ethics, including myself, is something called cosmopolitanism ethics, which takes seriously the idea that every human being, or the moral equality of all humans, takes it seriously, which means it believes that aid to strangers in other countries is a serious matter and substantial aid should be given. It means that, in fact, we should be thinking about principles of human rights, humanitarian issues. We take those seriously, not only in our lives, but also in our journalism practice. And most journalists who, in my view, embody this global feeling are attracted to making, as their principal values, what I call global-minded values. Again, human rights, notions of global justice, right? Democracy around the world, global structures, and so on and so forth. And implicit in this, and this is something we can talk about, as we go into global formulations of journalism, is we get further away from the journalist as a spectator, as an objective, impartial, detached spectator, to a journalist more as an agent for reform and global reform. That's contentious, I understand that. And so notions of objectivity start to be discussed and debated. If I had to tell you, what is GME's, where are the I'm very bad at drawings, as you can see, but there's actually four interconnected levels here. If you're interested in theory on this stuff, we have people who write about what is the global ethics that should undergird global journalism practice. Is it a religious code? Is it a cosmopolitanism? What is the philosophy here, right? Also, they then say, well, let's say we assume some particular global philosophy. What does that mean for media ethics? What does that mean for how journalists see themselves and so on? On the more practical level, there are people, and I'll give you examples, who are actually trying to create guidelines and new codes that deal with the global issues that I'm talking about. New work in media ethics. And of course, feedback from practice. When people actually practice some of these values, they learn more about the principles they're using, and hopefully it's a virtuous circle that goes on and on. So what would change if we adopted global media ethics? I'm more concerned here with journalism. I know the media journalism thing is an ambiguous thing here, but I'm speaking more about journalism here. First of all, I think the self-consciousness of how journalists think of themselves. This is my view I'm giving you right now. There's people with other views here, okay? My view is that journalists would start to see themselves as a global citizen of the world, see themselves as a global agent that is promoting, again, human rights and sort of affirming humanity and around the world and so on and so forth. And in fact, they would make that as part of their identity. That is what they do. I am not just a Canadian reporter writing for Canada. I did that. I wrote from a parochial point of view. I wrote years from that point of view. I was a foreign reporter where I was expected to give the Canadian perspective on things. And I was called unpatriotic so many darn times. I can't remember. Whenever I wrote anything that questioned the Canadian mission to a war mission or whatever the soldiers were doing in Bosnia, Yugoslavia, or whatever. And the premise of those criticisms was, you're a citizen of Canada first. You're not a global agent first. You might want to take that into account later, but not first. So I think there's a shift in the identity here that's important. Ethical principles get different. If you start dealing on the global level with global issues, what, for example, and there's so many things we can talk about here, what, for example, does verification mean? If you're covering the terrorist attacks in Brussels and you're seeing that unfold, you're living in a communication space of agenda-driven people, false images, misinformation, and lots of probably accurate information also. What does verification mean in that situation? Or, for that matter, impartiality. What does it mean to be impartial on a global level? Right? Do I give every country a voice in the story or whatever, right? So those are the problems we're trying to work out. Practice, how do we actually work with global issues? If you really want to know more about this, what do we talk about in global media ethics, you can ask me to send you this stuff. This book here that I edited gives you all the different themes that come up in global media ethics. I'm not going to go through all this. I do have a sample code, what I think, at a very general level, what I think that... the global media ethics would look like.
There's copies on the table.
Oh, and there's copies on the table. And then, so I pretty well say, in fancy language as it were, what I've just told you the past few minutes. So, but here's it. This notion of GME, it's only a project. It is a work in process. I would say there is no actually existing global media ethics out there, if you think that means a set of principles that everyone or most global journalists agree on. No, it's a work. People have different approaches, different codes, different values, lots of debate, lots of different cultural, lots of different international approaches to this. And so it's not settled. I would call it emergent ethics. Emerging, but not dominant. Emerging, trying to get a beachhead on parochial ethics, if I can use a metaphor there. And it is a zone of contestation. I expect all of you to disagree. it is very, very controversial. And for example, people say, well, don't you need universals in the global ethics? What the hell are they? Are there any universals, right? How can we ever get journalists to all agree on this anyway? And, you know, isn't it just utopia, right? Okay. Here's what I want to talk about, prospects for realization. I'm going to give you the bad news, all right? Or what I consider to be things to worry about if you like the GME project, all right? And I'm going to start with the most global, most general ones I can think of. Number one is we live as journalists now, we work within a completely, do I need to tell you, different communication space, right? A different communication space where in fact, you know, the impact we could have a good journalism right now is relative to that space and the ambient society and culture. I once said that even if all journalists today decided they were going to follow norms of good journalism and be able to put them into practice, there would still be a heck of a lot of unreliable crap out there, right? So it's relative to the communication space. And this digital space with the many new voices and so on and so forth is something we need to think about. What is our impact as journalists in that space, right? Here's the old model before the digital revolution. The journalists stuck themselves in the middle. They had a virtual, almost virtual monopoly on providing the public with information and news, and they had the professional code of ethics circa 1920 up till about 2005. And then the public was dependent upon them to provide this information, right? So the gatekeeper role, and I'm sure you've studied all of that. But here, we've got a media-saturated world with all kinds of new players and the professional press with a diminished role. I'm sure I need to go on. I'm not going to go on much about that. But the worrisome conditions is that even if you're a good journalist, you're only one voice on any big story. There's lots of people, for example, in any, again, going back to Brussels or immigration, lots of people out there on websites, on social media, pushing another type of journalism, another points of views, and so on and so forth. We also know that there's a whole question of who is a journalist anyway out there, and there's all kinds of agenda-driven journalists and so on. So we have a contested, manipulative public sphere of global ramifications and incredibly diverse in who participates in it. That's now the ecology in which I work as a journalist. And so even if I try to get the truth or be objective or a great story, nail down the facts for the public, this still may neutralize its overall beneficial effect. So that's a worry for this global media ethics. I mean, if that's the case, how can we ever, turn this around? Also, it also seems to me, and do I have to tell you, in the middle of a presidential campaign, that we live in an era of incredible partisanship. I don't know why. Maybe it's because the media just makes us aware of our differences more. I don't know. That's something we can discuss. Of incredible division and inequality, social inequality, and, yes, partiality. And, yes, when people get divided and economic stress, they start to fear. They're worried about terrorism. They get angered. And there's always demagogues going to come around and say, and politicians come around and say to you, hey, you know, you got a right to be grieved about those other people, right? Blame others and give you simple answers. That's my view anyway. That has been used down through history. And that, in the case, makes it very difficult to try to do a more complex journalism That doesn't give you simple answers, right? And of course, patriotism, I mentioned, is an issue here. If you're going global, you have to understand, well, what form of patriotism as a journalist is acceptable for me? There's moderate forms of patriotism, there's constitutional forms of patriotism, there's communal forms of patriotism. What forms of patriotism are compatible with this form of journalism? There's educational issues. I put a very blunt quote here, but what if education, our education system in this country and in Canada or any other country, is inadequate to give them the knowledge of the world they need to figure out these global issues and to analyze the media they're getting, right? And Andy puts it, you got to go to a comedian or a writer to get this. You know, stopping Trump is basically fixing the educational system so they're not so ignorant to vote for Trump. If you're Trump, you can put there any other politician's name as far as I'm concerned. I didn't quote that just to beat up on Trump. What I mean is that I'm worried that, in fact, in our schools, we don't give them the ability to appreciate global issues. And then there is, of course, and believe you me, since I left the practice of journalism, all my practicing journalists remind me every day how idealistic global media ethics is. That, in fact, they're run off their feet, they don't have time to do the sort of good journalism I'm talking about. There's centralization. In Canada, it's unbelievable. I mean, well, in terms of newspapers, too, in the United States, but in Canada, we just laid off hundreds and hundreds of journalists. And we consolidated all kinds of newsrooms, right? And layoffs. So that's depressing. I mean, are the resources there, and so on. Focus on profit, survival, even satisfying audience with clickbait. You know, we used to ask, well, what does the public need to know? But basically, what does the public want? You know, how do we catch their eyeballs is the question now. And maybe there's not enough media who care about this thing anyway. So I'm giving you all the bad news, right? Right after. How about some better news? Y'all ready for better news? Say yes, even if you don't. Okay. All right. There is some really interesting work at the level of theory. I got a different group here. I got some probably practicing journalists. I got some, but these are, I guess, for the professors. I don't know. There's some really interesting work being done. Never mind my book. But as you can see, new journals, all kinds of academics and journalists too are writing about how do we do journalism at a global level better. So new ideas, new theories. I'm not the only one out there, obviously, doing all of this. There's conferences, roundtables, media ethics sites, and so on. All right. So I take heart at that. I think there's some good work being done there. I also think we're getting closer to a more realistic notion of the role and place of journalism in that communication space I talked about earlier. This is a project, I don't know how many are aware of it, the Worlds of Journalism, Thomas Hentges at University of Munich. There's dozens and dozens of academics and other people who are working to compare journalistic values around the world. Where do journalists agree, where do they disagree, and so on and so forth. And one of the things they've done in one of their very large projects looking at many, many journalists in many countries, was identify how journalism, this is what I've been preaching in ethics for years, but they put a nice diagram on it, that individual journalist, is actually embedded in all these levels, right? The level of their own organization, first of all, their own newsroom. The level of for example, of the media culture and media system of their country. And finally, of course, globalization of media and that whole global level. And they're able to point to and study a whole bunch of different ethical influences on ethics, and I can't go into all this detail. But this is just an example how this is the sophistication, maybe even better than this, take it even better, if we're going to understand journalism in today's world. There is also engaged journalism. Has anyone heard this topic? Engaged was, in my view, the buzzword of 2015. Often it just means attracting audiences. For it, you know, so they, you know, to raise, so you're economically viable. There's no books out, but I want to point out right here that at the University of Oregon, at the Center for Civic Engagement, are defining engagement in terms of journalism as bringing together journalism and communities closer together. And I can't go into all of this, but the reason I mention it is I think a lot of global journalism and global journalism coverage is in an engaged form. For example, lots of reporters want to talk about human rights by going to the actual communities where human rights have been violated and spending lots of time with people, documenting, giving them the power of the microphone to tell their own stories, and so on and so forth. And I'm wondering whether this notion of engagement in the local national level could be used to define engagement at the global. I just want to mention this, if you want an example in Civil Beat, where they did a story on the homeless, where the reporter, Undada's encampment, I'm not sure what the right word for it is, but for the homeless, and spent 3 months there living among them, and then wrote a very interesting three-part series called The Harbor. But what's really interesting is that the reporter, Jessica, actually detailed all the ethical issues that she came across while she was getting close to people, right? So there are lots of ethical issues there. In terms of my own, the other sort of aspect is knowledge journalism. In many ways, these are all the things that people I see out there that are trends in journalism. Engaged, let's be participatory and collaborative, let's be entrepreneurial, let's do innovation and disrupt newsroom traditions, blah, 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 all these convergences, so on and so forth. But a lot of these have to do with skills. And what I think that we need is actually knowledge and content about the world. We can't lose that, and I'll come back to that theme. So the good news is there's lots of people who are starting to do global journalism at schools of journalism and elsewhere. Here's one from the University of British Columbia. I would pick on the former place where I'm still affiliated with, but I co-founded the university journalism school at UBC. And here is what happened is we went out and found a young entrepreneur who had a lot of money, was worried about investigative journalism. She gave us quite a bit of money to actually run a global course, which means the students every year get to go to 3 or 4 countries and see and compare and see how a particular issue is playing out. Last time they did mental illness. How were the mentally ill treated in India? And what was the other country? It was 2 or 3 other countries. And they get it posted, they get it in the New York Times or NPR or whatever. And so this is where I think a lot of schools of journalism can develop. Also, I think there's really good news with respect to journalists themselves and their associations are starting to come together to develop new ways to handle global issues and report globally. How many people have heard of the Ethical Journalists Network? They're based in London, basically. And basically, it's a call for professionals around the world, professional journalists, to come together and start drawing up codes and norms and various new practices that help the quality of global journalism. There's the International News Network, of course, which is nonprofit journalism, if you've heard of that. There's a whole bunch of centers who use foundation and donation money to set up their own website, and they start doing stories, for example, about a particular subject, like the Pulitzer Center for conflict reporting in Washington. And in fact, there is now an international network where they all share ideas, share information, collaborate on stories, and so on. All right. So I think that's actually in the spirit of global media ethics, and of course. How many have heard of the Panama Papers? The Panama Papers was, 11 million documents leaked through encryption. I think they first leaked to a German newspaper who shared it with the International Consortium of Investigative Journalists. And then they hauled in journalists from, I think, about 60 other countries, including a friend of mine, Rob Cribb from the Toronto Star, and so on and so forth. And they recently started publishing reports on using offshore sites to hide money, launder money, and so on and so forth, and implicates all kinds of leaders. For me, this is not global media ethics in theory, but it's global media in action, right? And that's the sort of networks. That's what I mean by networking. You can have a lot of power if you act together. I won't go through that one. There's also lots of new guides, if you want the good news on this. Lots of people are creating really practical newsroom guides for how to cover stuff, and they include how to try to handle terrorist acts and cover terrorism, from the language of terrorism right on down to how to develop stories amid all the confusion that always happens after an attack. Of course, immigration. There's new guides on the use of hate speech, which is often happens with regard to these number of issues. 1 and 2 people make. Not only hate speech, but very, very strong, strident comments, and how much publicity should you give them, when should you pick them up, and so on, and climate change, and so on. So I'm not going to go through all those. I'll just let me just show you some examples. The NPR has done one for consumers, right? The terrorism edition. This is advice to consumers when you're listening to the media covering a terrorist attack. Here are some things you should remember, right? That often it'll all be wrong at the very beginning. Go with verified sources. Try not to pay too much attention to politicians. They're going to say stuff that's self-serving anyway. You don't have to agree with all of this stuff. The language you pay attention to the media users, their masterminds, and so on and so forth. And this is what I see is what I call media ethics for everyone, where you start involving guides that include people who themselves now are creating media content. So things we can do, coming to the end here. You know, here's just some ideas I'm going to throw out at you. Number one, I don't know if anyone's aware of this, but Harvard, the Shorenstein Center for Press Politics, produces something called the Journalist Resource. I don't know if you get their alerts. What's really great is that if an issue breaks today on a particular issue, it'll come out and give you the top research articles in that area, the top background. And if you're a journalist, it gets right to the point. Here's where current thinking is on this. Here's the factual basis of this. Here's the background. And that is, you know, if I was a working journalist, that for me would be really, wow, thank you. You know, at least I get somewhere to start, because I'm not in academia and I may not be aware of these studies at all. And so my idea is, why couldn't we do that globally? Why couldn't, when global issues hit, why can't we have a network again of academics and others working to help journalists cover those issues? Global fact checking. Do you know how many fact checking organizations have started in the past few years? I guess that assumes that the public wants facts, right? Who cares about facts? I'm being facetious. That in fact, you know, we're fact checking every debate in the primaries and the caucuses, right? And so on and so forth. I was wondering if we could do better at fact checking statements made about global issues, and what sort of center would do that, and how you would actually. I'm only at skimming the surface there. I don't have any deep, profound thoughts how you do that. But it would seem that would help. I think we need to have pilot studies that test the ideas I've just been mentioning. Right now, I'm interested in taking parts of my code and asking journalists how would that work in real situations. Right. So we're going to look at, later this year, I and a colleague of mine in Australia, we're going to ask Australian and Indian journalists to look at parts of my code. We're going to interview them, and they're going to tell us whether it's, you know, whether that would work or it would not work, and get some feedback. I think there's all kinds of studies we can do here that would be helpful. And most really importantly, I think journalism education here has to change. Not only do we need, you know, news organizations to come on board, but we need a journalism education that is not only about adding skills to the skill toolbox. Look, I was director of a journalism school. Every student I ran into wanted to say, give me skills. I want to get a job, give me skills. I want to find out these facts better. And that's all valid. It's all very important. But I worry that they don't know enough about the world. They don't know about international institutions. Do not know about religion. Do not know enough about religions, and so on, to actually report very well on them. So cultural knowledge. In fact, you would make just as good as argument that is, as journalism schools look towards technology and data computerization and so on, that in fact we should also be leaning towards anthropology and cultural sciences to give us some insight at what the world is like. Right? That's, I guess, my bias given where I come from. There's lots of other things we can do, out there, but I'm going to sort of leave it at that and just say that I don't think in this complex media world we're ever going to persuade everybody to follow these rules, but we can have a core of academics, journalists, and so on who care about this good journalism and to counteract the misinformation that's out there. So how far can GM go? Well, here's what I would think. I'm going to give you my hope. Realization is never going to be ideal and complete. I'm hoping that within one decade, 10 years from now, you'll all invite me back for the second speech, right? to show how I was wrong, right? 10 years from now, I would hope that in practice, that global media ethics, the principles, some norms, there's some agreement on them, and they're actually playing a part in major news organizations covering global events. I'd be happy with that if we get there. That it's actually having some effect in practice. I don't ask for perfection in life anymore, believe you me. In terms of theory, I would love to see global media ethics become a dominant theoretical force, be the sort of the way to look at journalism ethics in terms of publications and books and so on and so forth. I think we're at stage one right now. All we're doing right now, and all I'm doing right now, is injecting these little ideas into your head, these memes, right? I'm actually, we're basically going to conferences, we're writing books, we're giving talks, showing up on Hawaii public radio, sowing seeds, right? Trying to get global media ethics on the discussion table. The second would be where we actually start to codify these principles and get major news organizations who care about these things to actually adopt some of these principles and put them in their codes. I'm not sure that's going to happen, but I think that's where we might go. And then stage three would be where this becomes rather routine, and so on. And then the revolution is completed, right? And so on. So that's some of the realization aspects I wanted to talk about. Hopefully I've given you enough to argue and debate about. So thank you very much.
Yes. Either email me, almond@hawaii.edu, or Dr. Ward. So your email is sward@uoregon.
S. Ward.
Courtesy professor at the University of Oregon, the man gets around.
No, I also have another one up there for whisk. Doesn't matter, either
it's
one
on
works.
It's on the flyer I gave you as well. So Bev and Tom, would you mind coming on up? We've got a couple things to say. That's
perfect. You can talk to Devin, I'll let you go first.
If you're not familiar with the role, discuss it. We can critique, we can congratulate, we can praise, we can raise questions. I've been asked to raise questions, but first I wish to praise a little before we go in that direction. My name is Tom Cooper, and I'll be followed by Professor Bev Keeler. So I want to thank Professor Allman, Professor Ward, and of course Carol Burnett, and ironically, I want to thank the National Enquirer, without whom we wouldn't have this funny. I and many colleagues have greatly appreciated Professor Ward for years, and I commend his current book to you, especially if you value ethics theory and seek media reform. Stephen's work comes out of a long line of fine thinkers. We should acknowledge Carly Norden's strength, Clifford Christian, Cease Hamlet, Lars Broom, Porfirio Barroso, Michael Traber, UNESCO scholars, International Federation of Journalists, leaders, and many others who've been part of both an academic and professional literature for many decades. So there's really a highly positive tradition here, and many allies worldwide, not to mention finely tuned scholarship and philosophy engaged in this presentation. And he implores us to challenge parochialism, great idea to update and upgrade our understanding of the digital world, very necessary, and he relies upon both wise theoretical and sound practical aspects. So we thank you, Stephen. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Tom.
That said, Professor Allman has asked that I not just offer praise or criticism, but that I also raise questions.
Go ahead.
So here is some history which will build into question one. All treaties with Native Americans by the American government have been broken. Most human governments, if you look it up statistically, boundaries and policies have been historically violated or erased over time. We have had countless peace documents, treaties, and accords, and yet the world is chronically at war. Dozens of academics have created global ethics documents, some aspirational, some intended to be adopted, beyond those for the media, some of which seemed radical in their day, and yet we have more sensationalism, deception, unmonitored media outlets, unregulated communication, ethics case studies within this, the age of Enron, in a world of literally, and Stephen mentioned this, ethically challenged presidential candidates, often journalistically covered by ethically challenged journalists, in a world in which we might be trumped. Nations such as North and South Korea, Pakistan and India, those in the Middle or Muddled East, and the United States and its enemies are not only divided, such as corporally divided by beheadings, but they're also becoming a nuclear family, and I mean a nuclear-armed, dysfunctional, treaty-violating, macro-aggressive, divorced family. So my question is, no matter how much you move the theoretical chairs on the Titanic around, chairs which are new organizations, which are people trying to bring changes, things that we've always had, no matter how much you move the theoretical chairs on the Titanic around, how can you change human nature or self-interest? Can you alter the way that journalists and all of us behave as human beings off the record, whatever we want to look like on the record? And can you convert the intentions by the minority into consistent, seemingly accountable behavior by the majority? Question number one. If we were scientists, we would call for replicable, sustainable, consistent, reliable evidence demonstrated throughout the scope of history. So where is that evidence that human nature may be irreversibly and consistently transformed, whether within the media or at large? Question number two. In Stephen's excellent thinking, there's a modification of the dream, and he kept qualifying and qualifying and modifying today for universal code by saying, first of all, it only needs to be endorsed, not adopted. And I heard him on the radio this morning and read in his book that also he realizes he cannot include non-democratic countries in the code. But these non-democratic countries, depending on how you define them, include billions of people, China over 1 billion alone, and there are many other qualifications and caveats in this thinking. So question number two, is this possibility of a radical media ethics genuinely global? Is it internationally penetrated? Or is it the same old group of international cronies with new names and offsprings? Now all of this leads us to a very important figure in world literature, Don Quixote. If you don't know Don Quixote, it's usually required in liberal arts courses, but if you don't recall Don Quixote, it's the famous epic narrative. The central character imagines himself to be a knight errant and tilts with dragons and fights for the hand of his beloved Dulcinea. And to fulfill the quest of the chivalrous knight, he must protect an upright moral code and fight against the dark side. Sounds like Star Wars, doesn't it? When I read the novel, I was left to see Don Quixote as delusional, just as his family did, because he always strove to do the impossible in a world which was other than the way other people saw it. But that's the way I saw Don Quixote after reading the book. After I saw the play, Man of La Mancha, one of the most important and well-known and well-attended plays in world history, Man of La Mancha, in which we sing The Impossible Dream. It was based on the same famous book. After the play, we see that Don Quixote is living in an idealist world, yes, but it's one deliberately created by author Miguel Cervantes, who is also a character in the play. And what's emphasized on stage is that Quixote's quest inspires others. It not only inspires his closest friends, Sancho and Dulcinea, who sing with him, but it also inspires all of the prisoners, the downhearted in Cervantes' prison, to sing along. And it inspires an audience which leaves the theater singing about dreaming the impossible dream. It momentarily unites everyone in the theater in, quote, the quest. So despite reality, despite human nature, despite cynicism and skepticism and nihilism, we feel that we can be aspirational like Quixote. Therefore, despite the two questions, and there are a lot of despites there, that I have posed and which I hope we consider, despite that, I think that whatever the dire condition of the world, we need more Stephen Wards and more aspirational inspiration, or inspirational aspiration. After all, the role of the university in education is also about the quest. We may not agree upon what the truth is, but we agree that the quest for truth is important. We may not agree upon how to achieve peace, but we agree that the quest for peace is essential. And we may not agree upon the best code of ethics worldwide, or if one can work, but I trust we can agree with Stephen that the quest for a radically new and ethical mediated world is essential to honoring the dignity of humanity and to building a community of justice. So in that light, despite my questions, I want to thank you, Stephen. Indeed, those who quest might be called questions instead of questers. And that's what Professor Owen asked for today, questions. So I have two questions of one kind, but we have a room full of questions. If you think we're dreamers, we're not the only ones. That lead the way to answers. Questions always lead the way to answers, and they're needed first. And they're phonetic relatives to the quest. So here's to your work, Stephen, and here's to the quest. Thank you.
Thank you.
Is that on?
Yeah.
Well, I'd also like to thank Professor Allman for, and of course Christine, who helps at the department, for bringing Dr. Ward to campus. And my thanks to you, Dr. Ward, for your exceptionally timely lecture. This lecture served as an illustrious way also to thank Carol Burnett, as Tom did. And I calculated this is the 35th anniversary of getting the news of her establishing this fund at the University of Hawaii. I may be the only person on campus today who remembers that remarkable day in 1981 when Professor John Luter, head of our department, announced that Miss Burnett had contributed $100,000 to our small university and our very small department. That was also my first year of teaching of full time at Manoa, and I was able for decades to witness that the fund enabled our remote university to play a leading role in advancing ethics and professionalism in journalism, not only in Hawaii, but also nationally. Carol Burnett also came to campus to attend one of those lectures and to meet faculty and students. I was scolded for missing her visit that day, but I missed it because I was testifying at the legislature. So this is my very belated way of thanking her for her vision and generosity that has produced really notable results for the University of Hawaii and, I think, for journalism ethics. About Dr. Ward's proposed code, which I think you have here and which I'm kind of basing my remarks on, and its implementation, I'd like to offer two observations. The first, like Tom Cooper, is that I'm very troubled by the repeated references to democracy and the democratic framework for setting standards and principles. I fear that such concepts and language will be a put-down impeding the truly global dispersion of a much-needed code. Even media organizations and individuals operating in supposedly democratic countries might have a hard time accepting otherwise worthwhile principles or standards. I noticed on the slideshow here that the word cosmopolitanism has grown into it. And so I think editing and refocusing like that might be very useful. The second observation that troubles me is far more substantive. The proposal seems to say that today's revolutionary development hinges on the proliferation of all sorts of new media, their speed, reach, and output. But I see a different and a more far-reaching revolution. That revolution is the unprecedented global surveillance of all media and consumers of media by selected states. And these are the states that the public even knows about.
probably many more states or corporations or other entities are also spying on individuals or groups. Not only are they collecting vast amounts of data, but they have unparalleled means to process and analyze it, and then target individuals or groups for all sorts of purposes. So the whole basis of many journalist practices is confidentiality for sources of information. That can no longer be a guarantee by the journalist or even by the source. Therefore, a truly relevant code of media ethics has to call upon media owners, corporations, distributors of media products to acknowledge their own responsibilities. The first responsibility is to refuse to allow data being disseminated over or through their properties to be intercepted by others. The second responsibility is to call profitable media owners and corporations to exercise vigorously their freedom to publish and to serve the global public. First of all, by resisting closing down of their media outlets. Where are the media ethics to resist closing down profitable newspapers or reducing the number of television stations in local areas, as has happened in Hawaii and elsewhere? Also, exercising freely their freedom of publication to report global issues. The trend now is to withdraw foreign correspondents from active reporting in all sorts of countries. So we're getting less coverage of media issues, more just dissent opinion and so on, rather than firsthand reporting. So as Dr. Ward has said, his media code is aspirational. It is also inspirational. And it comes at a time when, despite the closing of newspapers and television locally, we have such a diversion of the different kinds of ways we can also get information that I think that it's just a question that his code has allowed us to start formalizing some of this. His stellar initiative has lifted and lofted media ethics to a new level when peoples everywhere beg for a responsible information order worldwide. So thank you very much for coming.
You talked
to
that.
Hello. Wow, like I said, I'm stumped. A great question. Tom, of course, wants me to settle the question of human nature. Thank you, Tom. I was reading on the way on the plane over here the difference between Hobbes, who thinks that, of course, has a very pessimistic view of human nature, versus Locke and Rousseau, who didn't. This is the oldest question in the world. My own view on human nature is not something static. It's either naturally bad, naturally good. So we have the potential for both, and I've seen it in my foreign reporting. I've seen the most horrendous crimes in front of me, and I can see what humans can do to each other. And as Aristotle said, the human is way more scary than, he didn't use the word scary, way more fearsome than the tiger, because he's got rationality and planning for his atrocities. And so I know that. I know that throughout history there's been negative things, and even today all kinds of countries probably wouldn't let my book be actually published. What am I saying? First of all, the book and my whole project is intended to be to give us a very high and general level target at which to aim at. And it has lots of room for all the other arguments and questions that people have about it. But you've got to have something to aim at, even if it is Don Quixote-esque, even if it is idealistic. Ideals do become ridiculous when they're so far away from reality, right? You know, you're tilting at windmills, actually, now that I'm thinking of it. But my whole view was that I wanted to put a code out there that said, here's what, in general, the highest principles would be. And this does not at all, getting back to some of the other questions, leave out of account, although it had no room for it, the economic and structural and organization nature of journalism. I'm all for critiques of news organizations that aren't doing that. And in fact, I think they could use my, we could use some of my code to call them to account when the, and so on. The problem, there are many levels, right? We jump, if we talk about the economic and organizational basis, what we need actually is a public that actually cares about those issues. When Canada went through all of those layoffs and centralization of newsrooms, and for 6 years prior to that, 10, the Conservative Harper government slashed and slashed and slashed the public broadcaster, the CBC. Was there one protest in the streets? Not one protest in the streets. Was the usual editorials in the high quality papers? Yes. Friends of the CBC and so on, all right? And what I'm saying is that, yes, I think we need to haul that into account. I also, I'm a little scatterbrained because your questions are pulling me in so many directions. I'm gonna say this. I think the future of media is not just mainstream media. When I look for good examples of journalism and media out there, it is people creating the media that they need and saying, I'm never gonna get it from Fox News or whatever organization you don't like. We have the capacity to start creating all kinds of websites, all kinds of sites where we can at least try to do the sort of journalism we may not be getting somewhere else. But let's not let the so-called mainstream media off the hook, whomever we want those defined to be. In terms of democracy, what I meant was that I think basically my set of ideas would be very unaccepted by people who run certain non-democratic countries. And if we're going to look for the first place to start realizing it, we probably want to start with democratic countries. And I also think that the sort of reforms I'm talking about could also set some aspirational targets for journalists who work in these non-democratic countries. So I'm not trying to run those out of the picture. As for where my concepts come from, I've had this asked of me many times. I don't believe democracy is a Western idea. I think democracy is a fundamental human way of association that has historical roots a lot in the West, but hang on, we have writers who have shown that as hundreds of years, centuries of in India as a tradition. And so in one way, you gotta start somewhere. You gotta start with some ideals. Is human rights a Western concept? Well, let's get rid of it then, all right? What you have to understand in my methodological approach is that ethics is proposal. It is us proposing some values, the best we think for now. We put it out there on the global scale. Yes, other cultures will show all kinds of problems with that. And then we dialogue about that. And maybe we throw out some of those values. Maybe we change them. What better experience I had of that when I arrogantly, somewhat arrogantly, went to South Africa for a global roundtable with Cliff and Cliff Christians and everyone. And in the midst of my great standing up, I said to the assembled multitude of journalists and teachers, I said, what we must continue to protect is an aggressive, investigative journalism of corruption and holding leaders to account. And I got three people standing up and telling me, bullshit. Why did they use that terrible word? They were saying that's a Western view of what the media should be like. So their notion of what social responsibility was in South Africa was a media that works more with the government in a transitional stage, is less aggressive, and in fact is almost more communal. Now, the reason I bring that example up is that that's what we're going to have to do when we start dialoguing about global notions. It's not going to be Ward saying, here's the principle, fight over it. It's going to be a dialogue where we start to shape and show that these notions can have different meanings in different cultures within boundaries. It can't be stretched forever. But I certainly see how in a transitional democracy, your notion of what the media should be doing might be slightly different or maybe greatly different from the media we need in America today. All right. So I'm not sure I'm answering all your questions. Go ahead.
I know we have to wrap it up soon because I know students need to get out to their other classes. But Bev, did you have a comment? And then if anybody has a question,
I'd like to just add a point that I left out of this critique is you have alerted the media to accept some of the values that have been evolving since World War II and the advent of the atomic age.
Right.
It's not a question of changing human nature. For the first time, the atom bomb alerted people it's a question of global survival.
Absolutely.
And the most visible was the Declaration of Human Rights,
yes.
But it was followed by declarations like of indigenous rights and many other global values that are being universally accepted. And you're calling on the media to do this. I think the time is right for that. This is particularly important because some of the first peoples want more than a flourishing humanity. They want a protection of the environment. And this destruction
right.
is important
right.
to remember. This is the 70th anniversary of the first peacetime U.S. nuclear testing in the Pacific. So you're in the right spot for your message.
Good.
And it's
thank
a
you.
Message that has to go beyond, just ethics and it's a survival for the planet and
yes.
for people and the environment.
Thank you.
So thank you for coming at not only the right time, but the right place.
Thank you.
Does anyone
have a question?
Oh, sorry, I'm serious talking.
Thank you so much.
Yes, hello.
My name is Kate Jo, Denver Science.
Yes.
I like this global ethics, but I would like to ask you, is this ethics based on the individual as a global citizen, where as an individual, where humanity is where all individual as a base or as a group? I think this is very important. Unless we know that this ethics is based on what, then we do not know how to codify it. I like what you say, it's very, very good.
Mm-hmm. I would prefer not to sort of drive like a dichotomy between as an ethics of the individual or I guess the opposite would be ethics of society. I see these as social, these are social rules at a social level, institutional level that we should embrace as the social practice of journalism. But of course, it is embedded in that ethic is a respect for the individual and individual rights. I'd like to have my cake and eat it too. I'm not sure I can, but that I'm a social liberal. But don't use the word liberal. In America, it means something different in Canada altogether. It means you actually believe in, well, you believe in a core set of liberties at the core of society. But you're a social liberal if you believe that it has to come with help from government, from society, from justice and the rules of institutions. So, not to avoid your question, I guess I see my ethics as playing a role in, first and foremost, in the practice of journalism and at that social level.
I feel like there's going to be a death of a traditional journalist in a way. Not necessarily a complete death, but there's definitely going to be dwindling. Because the role of the media organization as a gatekeeper of information is starting to fade. Brands can take over the role of the reporter and tell their stories and news in an encouraging way, getting rid of the outside journalist, skipping over that main step. So how does this impact the global like media ethics? Will this in-house journalists with these individual brands have to follow the same standard as these other journalists?
I think I understand what you're asking. I would propose that this is a quote for anybody who practices journalism, offline, online, traditional, legacy, non-legacy. Okay, that's what I'm proposing.
Right.
Whether in fact those groups want to follow these rules. Beyond me, but I think that this. I'm not. I wanted a code that was not specific to formats or forms of journalism, simply because there's so many new forms and it's changing every day. There is a lot of work, and this is not a topic. This is my other side where I do digital ethics, where we're seeing every. I remember a few years ago, people said in digital ethics, it's too fast, it's too crazy. We can't have an ethics. It's a wild west of the internet. There's a lot of ethics and, for example, the Online News Association here in the United States is developing its own ethical guidelines. What we don't have, I think, is sufficient public media criticism of what's going on in journalism online, especially online today. I think we need a sixth estate. The fifth estate was the alternative media. The sixth estate is where we, with citizens and journalists combined, hold everyone who's out there writing on websites, no matter whether they call themselves journalists or not, to account. And we find ways to hold them to account. Those old newspaper press councils that tried to do that, they're totally inadequate in today's age. So we have to come up with a new way of holding them accountable. I'm not sure how you do that, except you shame them, you point out how they're wrong, you in fact have on these, you have coalitions of people who are criticizing them that are both public journalists, they're responsible journalists, and they're citizens.
Yeah.
Yes, yeah, if it's sued for libel. Yes, exactly.
Communications. I want to thank all of you guys for being here. I really enjoyed it. One of the things that I was curious about is a question that you talked about the comedian and talked about educating people.
Yes.
And you talked about the political campaigns. Yeah. I'm a former press secretary to a U.S. congresswoman, and my whole morning for a long time was picking up that newspaper and reading it from front to back.
Yes.
And I was decently okay before I got the job. Okay. It seems like such a problem that I'm guilty of, that I have friends who are guilty of. There is something about the internet. I subscribe to Wall Street Journal. I bounce back and forth with Washington Post and New York Times. And I inevitably always seem to like read the headlines, a paragraph or two, unless it really interests me, and then I stop. I got colleagues who are professors at other universities who gather their news from Facebook, and that's about it.
Yeah.
Are we going through a phase, or is there something about the arm that's feeding us the information that just does not allow us to get the really guts of the information that we need to make satisfying judgments in life, whether it's for a political campaign or anything else?
Yeah. Yeah, and as you know, there's been many studies that show where do people get their news from today, Facebook, social media, right, all that. So we're processing news, and also the other part of that that's really interesting is you're being alerted to that news item within a website or online environment that is interpretive and often very opinionated. So in the middle of somebody's Facebook says, look at this piece of nonsense. And then there's the article, right? So you're combining, so news and opinion are really, really buttoned up against each other. Yeah, you're right. I mean, there's all kinds of people worried that where our attention span is less, or we're not willing to work hard enough at our news and so on and so forth. I know lots of my friends will tell me, oh, you know what, they're just totally cynical about society and political process, so they've decamped. I mean, they're not even following the news very much anymore. I don't know how to answer your question. So I hope that, in fact, that is, no, there are counterbalancing situations. I know, on the other hand, I know lots of young people that I teach who are immensely interested in following even the political news, but I would say to that, they follow the political news different than I did when I was a political reporter. They're not so much interested in political parties and the machinations, although if you watch news coverage, it would seem that these journalists assume that's all we're interested in. You know, the super PACs are doing what today, and so on and so forth. And I think they're interested in particular issues, perhaps environmental issues, and they'll glom onto that topic and become almost be very expertise in that issue. Is that good or bad? But it's just a different, you know, my friends in Wisconsin have been studying this, and it's not all about. I mean, there are a lot more young people who want to get engaged in politics. So, you know, is it a glass half empty or not? I don't know. Well, I'm worried about it, like you are, very much so. I don't think I answered your question.
No, I think
y'all
are. Just
can we?
Anne, just give me the green light when you think I should
more
go.
More food.
There's more food.
Yeah, go ahead. I'm gonna get a drink. The regular one.
I'm asking your permission to continue.
Sure, yes, please, I'm delighted.
Okay, good. So for everyone who can still hear, I have students who I ask the question, how many of you have an opinion about Obama? All the hands go up. I ask, how many of you have an opinion about Lady Gaga? All the hands go up. I ask, how many of you have an opinion about ISIS? All the hands go up, and so forth and so on. And then I ask, how many of you have ever spent 8 hours off stage without makeup with any of these people? And none of the hands go up. Now, this is not just my students, but if I'm talking to a Harvard Club or a Rotary Club or anywhere, we have the same phenomenon. So I see the number one ethics issue now is totally transplanting what it used to be. I would call it the new epistemology, meaning that we think we know things we have no clue about. We think we understand things that we have not experienced firsthand, and we trade in a false, illusionary world based on all of that. That doesn't just mean us, but virtually everyone that we know. Therefore, the leading issue is media saturation. And it's very much like the guru at the front of the room who says, we are all free thinkers, and everyone in the back says, we are all free thinkers.
Monty Python had a line.
So my concern is that if we're still seeing ethical issues, primarily privacy, responsibility, and all the others, we don't see that the action we take in the world is based on what we think we know. And what we think we know is no longer what we know, but it's programming. And by virtue of that, we have a very different ethical landscape than even our parents had, and so forth and so on. Where is the space to consider this in the world?
Yeah. It's almost like Plato's cave, where you're seeing images flashed in front of you on a screen by the people carrying objects behind you. Everyone knows their Plato, I'm sure. If I get your question right, it's a very important point. There's the illusion of knowledge that's going on here, that you actually know what these people are like, because there's something about it that does that. And I think my only answer to that is my stress that we need media literacy, not just news literacy. That in fact we have to have some sort of organized way in which, at least in these schools that we teach in, I can't speak for others, that in fact we take that question in the course and we actually delve into it and ask the pertinent questions you are. There is so much acceptance. And I forgot to thank Anne for inviting me personally, but thank you before I forget. I give you a little experience before I came up here. She got me online and MSN, or they came up as the browser or whatever, and I could not literally easily tell between news and sponsored content. Every now and then a little flag called sponsored content. How many people do you think who not media savvy know what the hell sponsored content is anyway? And the difference, the sliding difference between advertising and news, as an old reporter, drives me crazy. But I know it's sort of the way of the world, and I guess transparency is usually the way out of this. I agree with you totally. There is what we have to get into is the epistemology of how we think we know what we know on the internet. Yeah, good point. And I also want to just point. I forgot to the whole notion about surveillance. I totally agree with you. I gave a talk in West Virginia on that. That in fact, that is a huge problem. We're in fact a media war, a worldwide global war of the hackers versus the people who are trying to surveil us. I mean, we've got to fight the surveilling part. Well, I mean, some people think we have to get WikiLeaks encryption. Just actually maybe get some, there could be a legislative, but I'm skeptical about whether laws are going to do that. But I think people, I'm not sure, also get public opinion behind it, because I'm not sure people were all that upset. It's not enough people were upset to find, Snowden's. Yeah, not aware. Yeah. Sorry. Yeah, did you want to ask a question? Yeah, go ahead. Just give it back when you're done.
Sure. My name's Lindsay, and I'm a student of political science, and I'm also an affiliate at the Hawaii Research Center for Future Studies. And so we have a listserv where we center on different articles that cover emerging trends, and especially with technology and different research that's going on. And then every once in a while, there'll be some articles about futurists. And we sort of laugh because they tend to be sporadic and just come every once in a while and talk about sort of these grandiose utopias or different visions, and then, you know, maybe they'll mention the Italian fascist futurists, and that's kind of it. And this article will appear and again and again and again throughout like the years. It's almost like the standard futurist article. And so I guess I'm curious, you know, looking at this immense amount of data that we have, and also looking at images of the futures as well as images of the past and history, I guess I'm kind of curious in terms of, you know, journalism, how can, and media, how can we build in long-term thinking and also break this constant now cycle that we seem to have, where it's a 24-hour news cycle and it only feels relevant if you're in the present, but then there's only such a short amount of time that you spend looking at that issue. So it doesn't really allow, you know, some sort of deeper thinking of what long-term implications could be. And so I guess I'm curious about like where that's come up for you in discussions and what you think about.
Well, I mean, I know what you mean, and I think that almost relates to a previous question about how we're transfixed on stuff. Yeah, being timely and what's happening right now has always been part of journalism, but it's enhanced unbelievably. It's so quick, it's so fast, right? And we get to expect that, you know, to be reacting to that. I mean, I got nothing to say about that. I'm not sure what the solution to that, except that journalism ethics would want a substantial amount of other journalism available that is not based on quick hits, that is contextual, that is long form. There are some experiments out there where people are trying to run websites where magazine style and longer form. We'll see. I mean, we'll see whether, in fact, in this new communication space, people want that. Yes.
So how does, yeah, I guess journalism, the role sort of falls on different other narratives that are out there, right?
Yeah. I particularly, it's not just providing context, but actual critical context. I mean, we're talking about, again, sorry to get back to presidential campaign. But I mean, people are making statements, foreign policy is slogans. We build a wall, or we cut the head off ISIS, or blah, blah, blah. And I'm sitting there going, how? And the problem is, you know, what I mean by critical context is not necessarily I get up as a journalist and say, you're wrong, you know, that's impossible. But basically, how would you go about doing that? And if the candidate won't tell you, you can go out and do an extended, in-depth piece on that. That it assumes, by the way, the people, what you just talked about, that they don't want just the now. They want to worry about how we're actually going to do it.
Yeah. Takes money.
Yes, resources.
Economic yes.
Is there one more?
Yeah, Susan Kreifels.
Yes, of course.
I'm Susan from East West Center.
Yes.
And I have the media programs there. And I'm developing our international media conference in New Delhi. So one of the global journalism themes I think is really important, since I have some good minds here, is that algorithms are becoming the gatekeepers and the editors. In an age where growing significant numbers of Americans and also international people are getting their news on social platforms. So could I just throw that out just to hear your opinion on that? It's
algorithms, that's what the audience wants.
Algorithms becoming the gatekeepers and editors.
Oh yeah, and that's turned into, you know, what we call clickbait and all that stuff. My view is that I'm very worried about that, of course, because there's two senses of giving the people the information they want. There's an ambivalence in the word want. One can be just that, you know, it's sexy or eye-boggling and then we do algorithms on that and whatever. Or we actually, as journalists, take some responsibility of you saying, actually, you should know about this, even if you didn't think you wanted it. And I'm going to actually tell you something that is really going to upset you. If you're so concerned with satisfying your algorithms and your audiences, you're going to do really weak journalism. You're going to do please me journalism. And there's got to be still room in journalism for aware. And I don't offend you personally, but I actually say something which you get all, right? I love that. I mean, I come from a school where I love reading. I read everything from the left wing to the right wing. And, you know, at times I read The Economist, which is right of center, and I say, well, I'm not sure I agree with that, but damn it, it's a pretty good article. And a lot of facts, right? So they force me. So critical thinking is so important in this exercise, and it's the theme that Tom was talking about, I think.
Can I say a word about that, or are we running out of time?
It's up to the boss.
We can't get out of this room
been a long time since I've been in the White House, but one of the things is that...
Were you president, Tom?
I'm running, so as far away as...
You got my vote.
Is that not many people are aware that if the president gets maybe 1,000 responses to something, you may have 500 that are favorable, 400 that are favorable. The White House wants to know that. Then there's 100 that are other, and those never get considered. The only new and fresh and vital ideas probably come in the other category. But because it's all computerized and it's controlled by magic numbers, algorithms, and everything else, and not just for that president, but for much of the world, you cannot track the response anymore, except mathematically. So individual ideas, creations, and so forth fall between the cracks in an age in which yes and no binary operations increasingly drive not only government response, but media response.
It is really a really good question. Is it possible that when people decided this whole notion of saying things not being politically correct, and that's a whole other topic, that somebody did an algorithm and said a lot of people, that'll work for a lot of people, if you keep saying, I'm going to say something that's not politically correct. I wonder if that was a product of algorithmic thinking.
Oh, it's even more troublesome is that mainstream media are relying on those algorithms to get more eyeballs, and so, yep. You know, the ones that still have gatekeepers
are handy. You know, the battle is on because, I mean, I think of who I was telling someone that I'm a judge of several journalism awards. The submissions at the top shortlist are as good at journalism as I've ever seen. Oh my gosh. The irony is we've got the best tools, the research tools, the ways of telling stories we've never had before. Why aren't we happy? Right? And my worry is that how much of that good stuff is actually being done, you know, relative to the past. I can't quantify that. I don't know.
Well, thanks to everyone. Thank you all for coming, and thanks, Bev.
Wonderful.
And Tom, our discussants, yes, as well, and all your terrific questions.
Thank you. Thank you very much.